So we were driving through limestone country, heading out to gold-bearing land, and we saw these amazing limestone casts. I asked him if we could stop and have a look.
Jumped out of the car, for some reason, chucked the keys in my pocket. We've climbed up over all this limestone and when I got back to the car, no keys. It's such a stupid thing. There was no reason to even take the keys out of the car.
Working such extreme and remote areas, Andrew and Jacqui always leave their vehicle unlocked.
I'm just hoping that I can pick them up by retracing the steps, but it's not looking good.
Their only chance is the lost keys might trigger his detector.
No car out this way is just so dangerous, whether it's snake bite or fires or even a simple injury. We need the vehicle to be able to get to help.
The closest support base is the Palmerville Cattle Station, a four-hour walk over a rugged limestone range in 35 degrees Celsius heat.
I wonder how Jackie's going with that sat phone. I hope she's having a win, because I'm certainly not.
Yep, so we just need to organise a way that we can pick up our keys. They've got a spare key at the hire car company.
Worst bit is, we're not even really in gold country. We were cutting through to it. We're in the limestone country, which historically isn't known for gold, so I've put us in a pretty bad position, really. We're almost back at the car. It means I've basically retracked all my steps now. Oh, this isn't good. I don't think I'm going to find them this way. Ah. So if we can't get help, it's going to cost us both money and time, which is just so bad for this trip. We're relying on this to set up our season.
Andy!
How'd you go?
Yeah, I got in touch with the station. They said to speak to Matt, so I spoke to Matt. He said that he can pop into the hire car company, pick up a spare key for us, drop in and see us. So I sent him through where we are. He said he's got a lot of work to do, so it could be a couple of days, not sure.
So I'm having a bit of a think while you're gone. There's that big creek that runs right in through this limestone country. Remember the boys at the station were telling us about the big water holes in it. So perhaps that's worth a detector or a bit of investigation, eh?
Do have the underwater detector.
It's all we got at the moment, and it's the only shot we've got. Right, check that out.
Whoa!
That's some of the clearest water I've ever seen.
Oh my God, I did not expect to see this here.
Gold being so heavy, it'll always try and get to the deepest section it can get. If there's any gold to be found, it'll be found in those water holes.
I'll take the detector just up here where it's a little more shallow and just get it going and see how it works.
So when you're going to go looking for gold in new country like this that we haven't even really researched, we're going to start in the creeks.
The way gold works is gravity, obviously, and it does collect in those deep gullies and waterways.
How do you know there isn't any crocs in here, though?
Oh, I don't know. There's one way to find out.
The rule about swimming up here in Palmer is if the water's murky and you can't see the bottom, steer clear.
Trying to find out what it's like, eh?
How is it?
Bloody beautiful.
For thousands of years, water holes like this have offered relief to people living in the tropical heat of remote northern Queensland.
So I'll be chasing in around all these rocks where the gravels are caught up on these big boulders here. I'm just hoping there's going to be a bit of gold caught up there as well. So this is what we use as a snipe bottle. When you see something underwater, you squeeze the water out, and as it sucks back in again to fill the bottle up, it'll suck up anything in front of it as well. So hopefully we can put some gold in front of it.
Here we go. She's in the water. I brought this along just as a backup detector in case any of ours break or malfunction while we're out there. It just has the added benefit of being able to go underwater. So the plan here now is to detect through these creek gravels here. This is sort of the lowest area where if there is any gold around here, it would have got caught. Hey Andy, how are you going?
Nah, not a thing.
Me either.
What I might do is I'll suck up the gravels out of this deep hole down there and pan it off. It's about all I can think of. Well, let's pan it off and see how we went, eh?
Yeah.
The geology of the rocks in the pan doesn't look great. There's really not any quartz or anything. It's just sort of shaley, light, loose, sandy stuff. Yeah, not a thing in there, mate. You know, if there's nothing in there, I don't think we're going to pick gold up in through here anyway.
No point even detecting.
Not really.
Today was a bit of a bust. We tried, but it just isn't here. There's not much we can do about that.
Come on, it's too hot for this.
Oh, really is humid today. It's probably the hottest day since we've been here.
There we go. That's part of an old saddle or something, I'd say.
It's that hot and it's that hard to work that if we don't get a bit of gold, it's really going to affect us, I think.
The hard work we're not even earning a cent for.
Jacqui and Andrew have been trekking for several hours in search of gold-rich ground, but still have nothing to add to their 1.3-ounce season tally.
Yeah, I'm getting a real faint signal. A lot of bad stuff's going on, so we could do us some good luck right now. Look at that. God, yes. Oh, that's such a relief to finally see some bloody colour in the hand. We really needed this right now. I'd say we've probably got half a gram of gold there, maybe 50 bucks. I mean, the amount of hard work we do sometimes to find gold, it means so much more than that. No choice now but to keep going, get this gold out and do that march home.
They need to allow 2 hours for the trek back to camp before it gets dark.
It's the noise we want to hear.
A bit stressed at the moment, just trying to play catch-ups now.
All right. Oh, look at that. Little ripper, that's a nice chunker too.
Whew,
all right. That's a good one. The first one was a relief, but that one's happiness. That's what we do it for. You know, that could be 250, 300 bucks worth of gold there.
Yeah, we don't have much time left in Palmerville, and with the way this last week has gone, we are definitely running out of time. Still in the scope. Hey, Andy, I'm on the board.
Nice one, mate.
Got myself a nice little piece of gold, so... it looks like just under a gram or so. Finally, I found what I was looking for. I feel like I've been searching all week.
The nugget adds nearly $80 to their tally.
Oh, we better hit the road, eh?
Yep.
But they've made little headway towards their 15-ounce season target.
There's no indicators nearby of workings or anything, so it's definitely one to pinpoint and put in our report.
Yeah, just dropping that pin now.
What'd you write on it? Snake Gully?
Yep, pin for Snake Gully.
Happy days.
Yeah, nice work, mate.
Hey, Matt, is that you coming in, mate?
Yeah, mate, I've got good news for you.
Woo!
Got a pair of keys.
After being stranded for days in rugged far north Queensland...
I'll go in and grab it.
Grab the key!
Jacqui and Andrew finally have a new set of keys for their vehicle.
Thanks, big fella. We'll talk to you soon, mate.
Have a load, mate.
Woo! Thank you! Woo! All right, moment of truth.
Yeah, considering what we went through this week, we're probably lucky to have any gold, so...
The pair struggled being so far from viable gold country, but their trek to the Hodgkinson Belt brought some success.
Let's just find out how we went, eh?
Yeah, this week really hasn't gone to plan. How did we do?
0.2 of an ounce. About 500 bucks, yeah.
After 2 weeks, Jacqui and Andrew's tally is 1.5 ounces. Putting their costly trip to the Palmer River in the red.
It's just not enough.
I know, that barely even covers costs, like really doesn't.
All right, we're just gonna have to crank it now.
We've only got a week or so left here in Palmerville.
Yeah, the pressure's just big, hey.